Hello and welcome to New Earth Lifestyles. I'm JaneE King. Glad to have you with us today. And today is November 6, 2014. Welcome. Beautiful day in downtown Manchester, New Hampshire, all a little bit on the wet side. It's still not really cold for this time of year. And so happy to have you here. And thank you to ManchesterTV.org and Manchester TV for this beautiful studio. And the ability to bring the show to you live today. And today, my guest is Tom McElroy. McElroy. How was the best
McElroy,
way to say
it? You got it.
McElroy, thank you, from Christian Science. He's on the board of lectureship. And welcome, Tom.
Thank you. It's
nice
good
to have
be
you
here.
Great. Christian Science, I've always wondered, well, not always, but I had a neighbor back in the 90s that was a Christian Scientist, and I know that when her children were sick that she would call on someone such as you, I believe it's such as you, to heal rather than going to a doctor. They were members of that church specifically for healing. I guess you're going to be lecturing soon as well.
Yes, I am.
But can you tell me any more about your background and what you do in the church?
Sure. Well, I'm a Christian Science practitioner. It's my full-time job. So I don't work for the church. I'm independent. I'm an independent healer, so I work for my clients, my patients. So that means that I pray for people for healing, maybe in a similar kind of way that your friend, when she called upon somebody to pray for her family.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm available to work with people, to pray with people about all kinds of things, whatever it is they're going through. It might be physical challenges, but it could be, relationship or career or finance or whatever it may be.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great. That sounds very fascinating. And so you call this healing, and I was also interested in the background of the church at some point in time, as far as Mary Baker Eddy.
Yeah.
She's a New Hampshire. This all began in New Hampshire.
Yeah,
that true?
She was born in Bow, New Hampshire in 1821. She originated here. She went to Boston. She went to a few places, but she came back here really at the peak of her career, not far in Concord.
Mm-hmm.
And she spent 16 of some of her most formative years in her 70s and 80s,
mm-hmm.
Really leading her movement, her healing, her Christian healing movement.
I see. Well, I'm going to gong to Mary Baker Eddy because I've been by her homestead. I haven't really gone up to see it there in Bow, New Hampshire, but that's another thing that always fascinated me. Someday I want to get up there to that actually her home right on, I guess it's on Route 3 in Bow. And so how did she come to this modality, this religion? How did this all happen? She was born in 1821?
Right, yeah. And her family were pretty strict congregationalists.
They were, okay.
Yeah. Her father had a very kind of fire and brimstone idea of God, believed in the concept of predestination, those who were destined even before they came to earth, either to go to heaven or hell. She didn't resonate with that.
Mm-hmm.
Her mom gave her a little bit more of a sense of God as love, and she seemed to be really devout in terms of her Christianity, in terms of her spirituality. And even as a little girl, wrestled really seriously with big concepts, including this predestination one. And there's a story of her, I think, when she was about 12 years old, getting pretty sick over it, getting a fever, and really, because she was thinking, well, what if some of my brothers and sisters don't make it? You can imagine a little girl just getting really troubled that maybe her whole family wouldn't go to heaven.
Right.
And she talks about in her autobiography about being healed when her mother just really embraced her with this bigger sense of God's love.
Mm.
So she joined the church, I think, because she was so sincere. They let her join, even though she said she wouldn't subscribe to every doctrine that was part of it.
The Congregational Church?
Yeah.
Okay.
And she remained very, very devout, I think, because she suffered quite a bit as a little girl. She had chronic health issues. She really understood suffering very personally. Mm-hmm. She really wanted to do something about that. She loved education too at the same time, because she was often held back from school because of her health issues. Mm. And she had a brother though who was in law, and he would home tutor her quite a bit. So her two great passions, I think, were really from the beginning healing and education. Mm. So as things went on searching for relief from her own challenges, she sought out a lot of different alternative methods, because traditional medicine at the time couldn't do much for her. So she looked into homeopathy and water cure and hypnotism and animal magnetism and all kinds of different things at the time. And she was just a real kind of open seeker. She had what she called sort of her falling apple experience, or kind of a moment of discovery she felt when she was in her mid-40s living in Lynn, Massachusetts, and was on the way to a temperance meeting and slipped on some ice and severely injured her back. Mm-hmm. The doctor called to the house just seemed to think she probably wouldn't make it. He said there was severe internal injuries. There was a article to that effect printed in the local newspaper. A homeopathic doctor was called too and didn't feel he could do much. She says her pastor stopped by on Sunday on the way to service and I think effectively said, I know what someone on death's doorstep looks like. You should make your peace with God. Ah. So her family and friends were gathered there with her too, and she says that she opened the Bible, which I think was really common for her to do, looking for inspiration. Apparently read a story of Jesus healing a paralyzed man, and suddenly felt like she could get up and walk too and be free, that was normal. Mm. And she apparently did. Wow. Much to the shock of everybody around her, including the doctors who stopped by later to check on her.
Wow.
So she had a relapse later that day when one of the doctors showed up and said this isn't possible, and really was kind of examining and saying, I don't see how it's, and I think she got very afraid again. Uh-huh. Well, maybe this isn't possible, and slipped back in, but she quickly recovered again from that. Mm. And was healed completely, not only of that, but of many of these chronic issues that had plagued her whole life.
Wow.
So I think that, coupled with so much of what she'd been learning through the other type of healing work she'd been exploring, really, from her point of view, showing her what she felt was the mental nature of health, kind of culminated in this. It's not just mental; it's mind. It's divine mind. It was her Christianity, her love of Christ, being this presence and activity of God ever with us, coupled with realizing that there's a real mental nature behind health, and so her sense of Christianity, then she really wanted to explore that. It was kind of a light bulb moment, I guess, for her.
Right.
So she spent the next 3 years just delving into the Bible, trying to understand what was Jesus doing when he healed. I think she glimpsed that maybe that wasn't just something for that time or that group, but that is normal for all people who understand the laws, the rules, the teachings of Jesus, and of those who were his students, who also healed. Mm-hmm. And so that became her life work, really, was how to understand that, how to help others with it. And that's where the education part came in. It wasn't just something as like a self-help just for herself. It was, she really, I think, wanted to help others be free from suffering, too.
Wow, what a story.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. And is this what inspired you, or what inspired you to change or to move into Christian Science as a profession?
She's an incredible woman, and I continue to learn a lot from her life and her example. Uh-huh. But I think for me, as probably with most people, it comes out of our own need. Something can be right there in front of our face for a long time.
Uh-huh.
I don't think you can be born into or inherit your spiritual path. You might be born into a religious community. Mm-hmm. And adopt certain religious activities or rituals, but I think at some point each individual has to find their own path, make it their own, make their own personal discoveries, and see it for themselves. And my journey was no different. One of the catalysts, and there was a few of them along the way, but one of the big turning points for me was actually after I had a big breakup in college with my college sweetheart, and I was really distraught over the whole thing, and I called somebody. I called a healer, a Christian Science practitioner, and this woman, she's a bit like Maya Angelou. you know, just kind of full of life, really soulful woman from the Old South. She started almost every sentence with, "Honey." And so it was was the same. I called her this time. I poured out my heart. She also had a real sense of humor. She listened to everything I said about this gal and how my heart was broken. And then she says, "Honey, is she cute?" And it's maybe a little bit like the gong there. It just broke this whole kind of hypnotism that I had over this situation. And, wow. And I kind of went, I laughed and I said, "Well, yeah." But then she said three words that I've heard many times in my life, but I felt like I heard them for the first time. And she said, "God is love, honey." And I felt it. Mm. I felt it in a way that just, it was like just thick molasses all over you.
Wow.
Warm, sticky, you couldn't get off you if you wanted to, kind
so
of a thing.
So say that again.
God is love, honey.
Wow, let's gong to that.
Wow.
Pretty powerful. That is. God is love, honey. And you felt it.
I just felt it. I felt it all around, and all that fear of lack and of jealousy and whatever it was, it all just went away.
Mm-hmm.
And then I kept talking to her just a little bit every day for the next couple weeks, because I was worried that maybe it would come back. Uh-huh. I was out of school. I was about to go back for the next semester. I knew I'd be seeing this gal again, and she just stuck with me. And then at the end, I had heard she was a teacher, and I said, "Tell me about your class." And all she said was, "I'll send you an application, honey." And I had a nice internship lined up for that summer. I felt it was very important to me, but this suddenly was more important. And so I took the summer to go and take this course. And after that, I just I thought, This is kind of the it of it, spirituality, helping people see that, finding it more for myself. That's like Technicolor, life in Technicolor, and everything else. It's still there, but it's kind of in black and white. So that was a real transitional moment for me.
Wow, pretty cool.
Yeah,
that's really amazing. So you've had that. So that molasses or whatever it was was almost like a feeling of touching God, would you say? Or?
Yeah, I think it was just a waking up to the fact that God was not far and not even on the other side of the room, just ever present and filling all space, and that I was a part of that and could never be separated from it.
Wow.
And that to me is often so much of what I feel healing work is whatever tools, whatever helps us get to recognizing and feeling and really discovering that. There's a lot of paths to do it, but one way or another, I think it's simple at the end of the day, but it's deeply profound, and it heals.
Mm-hmm. Simple and deeply profound, and it heals, and it changes lives. That's really beautiful. Wow. And so you're helping people the way this first person helped you.
Doing my best.
That's your goal.
Yeah, that's my goal.
That's really beautiful. That's really beautiful. Do you have any of those healing experiences that you could tell us about, that give us an idea of?
From my own practice?
From your own practice?
Yeah.
Is that possible?
Sure. Yeah, I've got lots of stories. I'll just tell you about the first time, one of the first few times, I suppose, somebody called me. It was the first time after I dedicated myself full time to the work. I'd had a few friends ask me for prayer and healing before that.
Can I just back up?
Yeah,
when, please. When you dedicated yourself to prayer,
yeah.
what was that like for you? I mean, did you get down on your knees and pray to God, or I mean, what was that like? How did that manifest?
Well, so I graduated school a year later, and I was kind of thinking, I'd like to do this full time now. And I remember really trying to pray about it. I had a degree in philosophy.
Okay.
And everyone was asking me, "What are you going to do with that?"
Right.
Which is not unusual, I suppose.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
I was starting to ask myself the same question. And one of the ways that I prayed at the time was just by writing. I would write out my thoughts, and I would write out my concerns, my questions, until I felt like answers started coming. And then I might kind of write in the answers as I went along too, and often it became less about my thought at that point and more about the inspiration. But it started just from a place of being honest with myself and honest with God in the best way that I knew how. Anyway, one day this thought came to me, and it was one of the most distinct messages I've ever had. So it was just a few months out of school, and it it was like directly to me, and I wrote out your job. This is like what I felt was God talking to me. Your job for the next 30 days is to do nothing but get to know me better. And
wow.
If you do that in 30 days, I will tell you what comes next. It was that specific, and it felt like a contract.
Yeah, wow.
And I signed it like a contract, and I folded it up. I put it in my drawer. I didn't tell anyone about it because I thought people would think I was crazy. And even for a long time, I didn't tell it like that when I told that story because I just thought, you know, who's going to believe that? But that was my experience. And so I did. I went on as much of a spiritual journey as I could. I let go of all my preconceived notions of what a healing ministry had to look like. I had a certain model in mind. And just really was kind of mentally down on my knees saying, all right, use me, whatever that looks like. Mm. And just trying to learn more about God, the nature of life, the nature of divine love. And about a month later, I had a friend come to town, and he said, I want to go out to lunch with this guy who's nearby. Come with us. And I did. That guy offered us both jobs. We both said no. We weren't interested. It was in finance.
Uh-huh.
A philosophy major, and my friend was a poet, right? And we both said, not our cup of tea. And this was in the, like, 6, 7, 8 years leading up to the big financial crash, you know? So a lot of people were jumping in to make a quick buck. It was just not where we wanted to be, and especially in real estate finance.
Mm-hmm.
But I got home, and the next day the thought came to me, this is what I had in mind, call that guy back. And so I did, and so that became the short version. There's some other little interesting details, but the short version is that became my career path for the next 5 years. You asked how I got into healing ministry, and the thing was, I wanted to do it full-time up front, but I felt led to this, and so I thought, well, this is it then. And I would kind of, I would get anxious. I would wonder, well, maybe I don't have enough faith. Maybe that's why I'm not, you know, out there doing it in a more overt way. And I would call the same woman back.
Mm-hmm.
And one time she said to me, honey, a plumber doesn't advertise that he's a plumber and then learn how to plumb. The idea being, don't wait till you have a title that says you're in the healing ministry. Just live it. Just be it. And then when the time is right, you'll advertise it. You'll take on that role, you know, in a more overt way. So I did. I did my best to just help people in the most honest, accountable way I could in this industry where it was very difficult. There were so many ethical challenges on a daily basis.
Ah, this was the finance.
It was the finance.
Okay.
And I did feel like I helped a lot of people. And at the same time, on another kind of seeming fluke, I found this chaplain group who was going into the prison system in L.A. And I started going in with them. And within, I was going once or twice a week working in high security men and women's. A couple of years later, I started working as well in youth probation facilities, mostly with gang members. So I had outlets for that all over, whether it was my business work or it was in the prison system, or we talked about this a little before the show got started, but
yeah.
A youth leadership program and things. So
mm-hmm.
It was kind of there, but then one day the thought just came to me, now's the time. You can let go. And I'd been really concerned about leaving. We'd been having trouble finding business partners that we could trust that could take over my role and leaving my clients hanging. And I got this idea, and shortly after that, the company restructured in a way that could have made me more money, but it also alleviated me of responsibility
mm-hmm.
where I could walk away and not leave anyone hanging. And at the same time, all my clientele dried up, and that had never happened. I'd always
clientele?
Had just
wow.
many people in the pipeline, and it was just really evident God is wrapping up the ends here. I grabbed my little box and my plant, and I walked out. And I just started, you know, saying I was in the full-time ministry and devoting my full time to that.
Wow. So God works in mysterious ways, but he kind of guided you through this whole process of helping people in the way, in the financial
yeah.
way, but
yeah.
then also helping you when you are ready. The business, the company you worked with changed its structure so that you could
yeah.
let go.
Yeah.
That's amazing. That's wonderful.
And it wasn't for me. It was for them, but it benefited everybody. It just...
Right, okay.
You know, I feel
win-win.
Like when we have... Yeah, exactly. Well, that's how it's supposed to work, I think. It's not
I believe that, too. Win-win
God
win
favors
is
some people and not others.
Right,
it's not a denominational thing. It's just truth is universal.
Truth is universal, and so is love, and so is
right.
it the ability to win-win.
Right, yeah. So So I feel like when we have a deeper sense of our purpose, God will use that. That coupled with humility and willingness, it just, when we're drawing on a source that's infinite, it's not...
We're drawing on a source that's infinite. Yes. Yes, that is true.
It's not limiting. Sometimes people think of spirituality or religion or religiosity as something that leads you to a cookie-cutter lifestyle that, you know, makes you look like everybody else and you can't be individual and unique. I think it's exactly the opposite.
The opposite. True.
Because the only thing that can be cookie-cutter is the stuff that's been done before, right?
Right, right.
But when you're drawing on an infinite source.
An infinite source. Never ending.
There's infinite possibilities.
There's infinite possibilities, and we don't know what tomorrow's going to look like when we believe in that infinite source guiding us and nudging us along. Or doing whatever.
You told me a story about after you took your first kind of course of study in spiritual healing.
Right.
Am I saying that right?
Yes.
And how you were in Boston, headed back up, and you got on the 93 North, and it was a parking lot, and how you let that same source guide you, and you found it guided you, and, you know.
Guided me out of Boston. That was, the same thing.
Gave you a creative driving solution.
Right. I started to drive on 93, and I saw it was a parking lot. I was in another realm. I don't know. I was being divinely guided. And somehow I got onto Stir Drive and got onto 93 another way where it was moving.
Yeah.
And, when I look back, I realized this was not me doing this. This was something greater than me, which was that infinite source. And when we drop in and trust that, like just making that decision not to get in on 93, being a parking lot, knowing that you're going to sit in traffic, just making that one choice kind of moved it all in a different way that worked.
That's cool.
And then just let go.
That's cool. That's
let go and let God, as they say.
Yeah, right.
Right? And that's what you do.
It led me in a career path. It led me in my relationship path, finding my wife. It leads me daily in what I do now. I think it's leading all of us all the time. It's sort of like the radio waves. It's just a question of whether or not we tune in.
Right.
They're always there.
Great.
But we got to tune in.
Uh-huh. And so people that might be watching, the audience out here, do you have any suggestions as to how they might tune in or how? I know you spoke about how you kind of did, but any other advice around that?
You know, I feel like there's a lot of paths, and a lot of times we focus more on what we do. You know, how to sit, or what to focus on, or what to listen to, or what to say, or what to chant, or something. And all of those to me are symbols, and to whatever degree they help people, I have tremendous respect for that. But I think it's beneath the surface of each of those symbols and paths. To me, the thing that is the key characteristic is the state of heart. It's qualities like humility and self-knowledge and love that I think, because you can go through the same ritual, can't you, without those things.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, that's just an echo of the truth. It's like shouting into a cavern that says, you know, God is love. It comes back as an echo, and you hear the same words, but it's not the same thing, is it? The echo is not the same thing as
the true voice,
the original voice.
Yeah.
So I think there's a constant temptation to just pattern and parody, you know, other people's, rituals, or to hang on, and it's fear. It's fear that causes us to hang on to one particular symbol and say, "This, if I don't do this the right way," and then we just end up feeling guilty when things don't turn out right. Oh, I must have done it wrong. And all of that, I think, can just go out the window. When we talk about humility, it's humility. It's not beating ourselves up. It's humility before something that is so good and so loving, unconditionally.
Mm.
And so we look to sources of wisdom and knowledge in order to have humility before what it tells us and let it transform our perspective of who we are, of what's going on around us. And there's lots of great ones, but... as a Christian, I look a lot at the teachings of Jesus and the writings in the Bible, and I see a lot of those qualities expressed there. What a lot of Christians call the Jesus' greatest, sermon is the Sermon on the Mount, and it starts out with these Beatitudes, and there's all those qualities just right there. Blessed are the meek, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. And so you see those characterized all throughout. And Jesus didn't give much of a this is how you do it as much as this is the state of heart that you have, and if you've got that, you'll be in tune. So that, to me, is what I try and focus on the most and help other people focus on. Mm-hmm. I don't tell them this is what you do. I don't give advice or counsel, but help sort of clear out the fear, the ego, the ignorance, and tap into, you know, what is natural for all of us, which is to feel like kids, children, in relationship with this, with our source, with our Father, Mother, God. And so it's those kind of qualities that I think help us do that.
Great. That certainly resonates with me, and hopefully others that are watching, that childlike quality, but the humility and of the love and the heart, and that is truly, from my perspective, where it's at. That's all there is, and touching in. So thank you for sharing that with us, and from your perspective, it's really feels good. It feels good to be here with you.
Yeah, you too.
Well, gong to that. We're all doing well today. And so you're going to be lecturing here in New Hampshire.
Yeah.
Coming up pretty soon. And in Plymouth and in Concord?
That's right. Yeah.
Okay. Great. And your lecturing will be, what do you talk about?
So actually, I'm giving a pretty similar talk both times.
Okay.
The official title is The Real You, No Limitations.
The Real You, No Limitations. Oh, I love that. The Real You, No Limitations.
I knew a gong was coming.
Wow. And you are talking about that from your own experience, it sounds like.
There'll be stories both from my own life as well as from the lives of people that I worked with.
Uh-huh.
And it's a talk about identity. Who are we? What uh-huh. defines us? A lot of times we look at that surface level stuff, and that's what we're drawn into. It's our past history, it's our families, it's our culture, our level of education, the amount of money we have, the mistakes we made, the successes we've had, the fight we had with our neighbor yesterday, all these kind of things, and yet to me, I like to think of it as like a spiritual identity or a spiritual DNA, and those are the same kind of qualities and characteristics that belong to God. And the Bible starts out by saying we're made in the image and likeness of God, and so that to me says that if God is love itself, then we have built into us the ability to be loved, to be lovable, to be loving. In fact, Mary Baker Eddy, her seminal work is called Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures, and that's considered the textbook of Christian Science. So this approach to understanding biblical teachings and Christian healing. And she has this great definition in the back of the book and a glossary. She takes all these biblical terms, and one of them you might imagine is God. And I think what she did was go through and look at all the rich ways that the Bible describes the nature of God. Like God is a rock and God is a shield and God comforts us like a mother and we exist under the shadow of the wing of the Almighty, like little chicks under the wing of a mother hen. She takes all these great analogies in the Bible and sums them up into, you know, seven words I think she would say are synonymous for the name of God. And she says that those seven words are principle, mind, soul, spirit, life, truth, and love. And that helps me to really think about that, because if I want to know who I am, then I have to know what God is and be discovering something new about that all the time. So I think about God as truth and God as life and God as love, and that then informs me a little bit more about my own nature, my own spiritual DNA, the kind of stuff that I think is untouched by all this exterior stuff that we often focus on and react to and think define our lives. But I look at that as like water on a plastic lawn chair. You know, like you put that chair outside, it's been raining all day today. You look outside and you might say, that chair is wet. But scientifically speaking, the water never penetrates. It never mixes or mingles with the properties of plastic. You know, the two mm-hmm. just don't become one. And if the chair is nothing but plastic, then you could also say in a way that the chair is not wet, right? Because the chair is nothing but plastic, and plastic never mixes with that water. It just sits on the surface. So all these other things that I think, you know, like the guys in the prison, you know, a lot of times they felt defined by their past record. The gang members, I might even tell this story, I often do, about this one kid who came in to a Bible study class I was doing, And I told you a lot of them were gang members. They often felt like, I mean, because dad was in the gang, grandpa was in the gang, brothers, you know, the teachers defined them as gang members. Even when they didn't want to be in it, they got jumped by the rival gang members. So they felt really predefined, you know. And I gave out this list one time with those same seven words: principle, mind, life, truth, spirit, soul, love. And all these little kind of qualities that you might say you could attributes you would give to love or to truth or life. Mm-hmm. And this one kid, he was the troublemaker kid in the class, you know, but he got quiet that day and he looked at this list. And he said to me, the first word on the list was intelligence. It was under the heading of mind. And he said, "What does that mean?" And I just kind of tried to describe intelligence. And then he looked at me and he said, "Are you saying that's who I am?" And I said, "Yeah. It's not my opinion. It's already there. I can't give it to you, but God already made it. Mm. We're just here to discover it. It's already in you." And he smiled. And then he got really serious again, and he goes back to the list, and he looks at the next word, and it was wisdom. And he did the same thing. What does it mean? And then, "Are you saying that's who I am?" And we went through all the words on this list. The custody officer came. It was time to take the boys back to their dorm, but he allowed this one guy to stay with me. We went through every word. And I feel like he was discovering himself for the first time.
Oh, wow.
A lot of times these guys, they're just told they're trash, you know? Told they're worthless, they're a burden on society. And so from my perspective, this was not a bad boy trying to become a good boy. It was like that spiritual DNA that was always there, and he just needed to see it for himself.
Wow.
So that he could act on it, you know? And he came back the next week. He was in my class. He was sitting right up front, and he was respectful, and he was kind. He was good with the other guys. He would raise his hand after that and say, "Hey, do you mind if I try and explain this concept that I was trying to explain?" He always had fabulous ideas, and he didn't go back. That's the thing about discovery. When you make a discovery, you can't go back again. Right? Mm-hmm. You can change your opinions. You can change your beliefs all the time. But when something, once it's discovered, it's done. You know it, and you
Isn't
move forward
cool?
from there.
Wow, so he improved his life from being in your course. How that must make you feel wonderful.
I mean, it's so inspiring to see truth come to the surface.
Yes. Wow.
It reminds us of what's possible.
Yeah. Gone to the truth of seeing a human being find himself. Wow, that is so beautiful.
So that's really a lot of what this talk is going to be about, and how discovering more about that has an impact, not just on our character, but on our health and our relationships and all aspects of our life, because life is not compartmentalized. You know, it's not like our health is governed by something else, but our character is governed by, you know, it's all one.
It's all one. Yeah. It's all about those seven things, and that's what God is.
Yeah.
And that's who we are.
It defines who we are. We have the same kind of qualities or attributes that flow out from that, or that belong to us, because we get all that we are from God.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so, sometimes I might speak about us being God.
Okay.
And because I think that we're one. I mean, we're all the same thing.
Yeah.
We're all the source energy. We're all source energy.
Yeah.
And some people get mixed up. Maybe I'm explaining it the wrong way.
Mm.
But I love the way you just put it, as these are all qualities.
Yeah.
That we have, that God has. Is that sort of what you're
saying?
Yeah,
absolutely. And we talked before things got going about the sun and its rays.
Right.
You know, and I do this sometimes if I'm working with little kids, I'll draw it on the board and I'll say, "What's this?" And I'll just draw a circle, and they all go, "A circle." And I'll draw on another page, "Well, what's this?" And I'll put some squiggly lines, and they kind of look at me funny, you know, and they're lines. And then I draw a circle in the middle, and, "Well, what is it?" "Oh, it's a sun." And you can see it.
Uh-huh.
I mean, God wouldn't be God without us, right? God needs a place to be expressed. God needs a place to, like, you can't have love without an expression of love,
right?
You can't have it without a place to be made manifest.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Bible says in Isaiah 43 that we're created for the glory of God, and the word glory means to make something known. We're here to be the place where love itself, truth, and life itself shine through.
Mm.
To me, there's a distinction, but at the same time, there's a oneness. So it's like, you know, a ray of the sun doesn't exist without its source. It is one with it, but it's not the source. It's distinct, right? It has its own individuality.
Okay.
But the two are absolutely united. You couldn't divide them.
Can't divide
them. Because you couldn't have a ray without a source, and you couldn't have a source that didn't have rays.
True.
Right?
That's true. I love that.
That's Every great. Analogy breaks down at some point, but that's one that helps me.
That's very visual, and it's very easy, yeah. easy to think about. Great. So
So these talks, they're going to focus on identity. And I'll tell people where they are so that I don't forget.
Where they are in the book?
No, where they are, where they're happening and when they're happening.
Oh, that where the talks where, are happening,
yeah.
yes.
Okay. So I have them on my phone. I'll see if I can remember it, but I might pull out my phone and look at it if I can't remember. The first one is in Concord.
Okay.
I will look at that because I have the address. And it's on Tuesday, December 2nd.
Oh, December 2nd. So yeah. that's about a month away.
Yeah.
A little less than a month away.
And it's, let's see here. It's at the Kimball Jenkins Estate.
Oh, yes. Okay.
You know that?
I know that.
It's in the Carraige House.
Nice.
And it starts at 7:30 p.m., so that's Tuesday, December 2nd.
Tuesday, December 2nd, 7 p.m.
7:30.
7:30 p.m. at the Kimball Jenkins Estate Carraige
yeah,
House.
Right.
And that's right off of 93, of course.
There you go. I wouldn't have known that.
Not far.
And then the second one in Plymouth is on December 7th, so that following weekend,
okay.
on Sunday.
All right.
And that's at 2 p.m. at the Plymouth Public Library.
Great. Plymouth Public Library. I don't know where that one is, but okay. 93 does go up to Plymouth.
Possibly the same thing.
We were talking about that, too, because you just moved to Boston a couple years ago, and 93 is the main route through New Hampshire.
93 and 95
Boston.
Are my two, the two that I know now, and I'm learning the rest slowly.
Right.
Yeah.
Great. And so you grew up in L.A., Los Angeles, and so this change happened while you were in college, but there must have been something in your life that kind of already kind of distilled you in this direction or sort of had you sort of set up on some level to be ready for this change that you've just explained.
I think there's just lots of little things, and I... you know, my parents both studied Christian Science.
Oh, they did.
So that was there. That was a tool that was given to me up front, and I'm so grateful for that.
Uh-huh.
But they also were really supportive of me exploring, which I'm also tremendously grateful for.
Uh-huh.
So I went and visited other people's churches and things. Part of the reason I loved philosophy was because I just loved ideas and people, and I just wanted to know, you know, what was out there. When the folks would come and knock on your door, you know, and want a hand, I'd invite them in. Tell me what you think. Tell me about it. Even in high school. And so there was definitely a love of that. There was also a need. Things were not easy in my family growing up. A lot of difficulties, especially between my father and I. And a lot of this as a tool that I had was what I leaned on, what I learned from, what reminded me that I was okay and that I was loved and that I wasn't alone and those kinds of things. So... definitely little things along the way, and sometimes, maybe I said this already, but I do feel like it grows out of necessity a lot, you know, or just love for others, love for ideas, love of truth, but often necessity is the catalyst, isn't it, you know?
Necessity to do what, or for what?
Necessity, just, you know, if the tools that we have at hand aren't meeting our needs.
Okay.
Whether that's with a physical health issue, we've been told something's incurable. Mm-hmm. You know, or can't be treated, or only, you know, whatever, painfully, or some relationship problem that doesn't seem to be, you know, you can't get through it, or some intractable family situation. You know, my relationship with my father and I improved. It took a while. It took work.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know how else that would have happened, but through being able to draw on tools other than what were at hand. Oftentimes I start actually the same talk, this identity talk, the real you. With a story about a counselor in high school who basically said, you're going to have all these troubles in life. You're going to have confidence issues and trust issues in relationships, all because of what he had heard about my family growing up.
Mm.
And that was really depressing, and I felt really trapped for a long time until I recognized, wait a second, there's another way to look at this, you know? And that's not it. That's not the final word. And it broke this mesmerism. I'm talking a lot, so I won't go into the whole story, but that's a moment of necessity when you just feel like, and people turn to all kinds of things when we feel trapped. Oftentimes if we don't feel like we have something we can turn to, that's when we just look for escape mechanisms, right?
Mm-hmm.
And those are often not healthy, you know?
Probably not, most of them.
Yeah.
Escape mechanisms are running in a fearful way,
yeah,
which lead usually to more fear.
Right.
Or
yeah.
something you don't want.
Yeah.
Right.
And it's a cycle, because then you feel bad about yourself.
Right.
Which doesn't lift you up any. And the more you feel bad, the more you try and escape, you know, running after the wrong kind of relationship or substance abuse or overeating or just binging on TV, whatever it is,
right,
you know.
Right, right. A lot of things are unhealthy out there that one thing leads to another when you're stuck.
Mm-hmm.
So, very interesting. So, Christian Science is all about the Bible and Jesus' work, what the Bible is about and about his ability to heal.
Yeah. I've had Jewish folks and Muslims read Science and Health, the textbook of Christian Science by Mary Baker Eddy, and say they love it and it helps them with their own faith. And so it's not that they read it and then became a Christian, you know, but they felt that it gave some insight into universal truth and into the nature of God. So I think big picture, it's for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
But I also think that you know, it's really grounded in the teachings of Jesus as an example that, you know, from what I know of anyway, is unparalleled, just in the way that he helped and healed people and what his life exemplified and what the people who followed him were able to prove in the spirit of that same
mm-hmm.
kind of love. I don't believe it belonged only to that group, you know, by any means, but
mm-hmm.
Just that to me there's no clearer example, and so I think that's really why it's grounded in those teachings in particular.
Right, and that's where it comes from. That's how Mary Baker Eddy came to it, through Christianity,
yep.
through the Bible, and
yep.
I don't know if there is another being that has been on the planet that has done the work that Jesus has done, has there?
Not that I know of. I mean, amazing folks throughout history and well before
yeah.
Jesus, and even people who healed and who ascended before Jesus, you
mm-hmm.
know. So the spirit of Christ, of the presence and activity of God has always been here, and it's not a denominational thing, but
right.
seems like Jesus exemplified it in a very unique way in human history.
Right, he certainly did. And I'm thinking about Buddha,
mm-hmm.
and but I think Jesus actually visited Buddha. Is that true, or learned about Buddha? I guess that was a, like 500-year difference, or there's a difference there in a lot of years. But
yeah.
Or Muhammad, or the other prophets of the other religions, they must have some similar story, but I don't know what they are.
Yeah,
so.
Well, yeah, there's great folks, and you see a lot of parallel ideas, you know,
mm-hmm.
and I think even as far back as you know, Plato, and I mean, you see it there. You see truth voicing itself.
Right.
And
that's what I was going to ask you, since you study philosophy.
Yeah.
I was going back into those original philosophers.
Yeah.
And their impact on you and moving you into what you're doing now.
Yeah. It helped to show me how big truth is, and I love hearing it voiced in different ways too.
Mm-hmm.
Gives us another angle on the same thing. So
mm-hmm.
I think it's good to be a seeker and good to be aware of what's out there.
Right.
So that was really helpful to me. And I, towards the end, I got kind of into existentialism and Taoism a little bit. And not that it became my practice, but like in existentialism, I loved the quality of authenticity. And that I didn't become an existentialist per se, if there even is such a thing, but I did take with me the idea of the value of authenticity.
And so is that what an existentialist is, an authentic person?
Yeah, from
really
my point of view, that's one of the I did my whole senior dissertation on the ethics of existentialism.
Oh, you did?
Which I'm sure sounds very exciting to everybody. But it just, you know, a lot of existentialists just talk about, you know, throw off all the preconceived notions. None of that is ethical in the same way that just being honest, you know, being true to yourself, you know, being authentic is. And so that can lead to some really negative things, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Nietzsche and nihilism and that kind of stuff is an extreme of existentialism, but there were Christian existentialists too, you know, who to me that says, coming back to the echo, the idea of just patterning the behaviors of other people but not really feeling it, not really making our own discoveries, tricking
mm-hmm.
ourselves.
Right.
It's that authenticity that reminds us, like, truth is not just something you can echo. You can't just repeat the word. You can, and you may look like you got it on the surface, But the only thing that will really heal, that will really change the world, that will really reveal to you the presence and activity of God is something genuine. It's not just echoing what other people have said and done. Mm. It's using that to find it for yourself and make your own discovery.
I see. So finding your own truth. And do you find that truth is different for each person? Or is there a universal truth?
I think there's a universal truth. I think it's singular. I don't believe in our truth, my truth, your truth. I do believe in my path, your path. Those are the ways to understand the same. Somebody gave me the analogy of climbing a mountain. Uh-huh. And the higher we climb, the more we come together till we get to the peak.
Right.
But there's different paths,
okay.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not to say anyone has to take the same path, but it is to say that truth is not just relative, you know, up to, you know, whatever you believe when you believe it. That we're actually, humility is the act of laying down your opinions and your preconceived notions and your fears. And discovering more of the singular universal truth and what it means for you, as well as what it means universally for all mankind.
So universal truth is the one source.
Yeah.
Okay. Or God.
Yeah.
So when you're climbing the mountain, that's where you're headed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Everyone's on their path to the top of the mountain, and we're all climbing up in our own way, but looking or heading toward that universal truth of divine love and God.
Yeah.
And source,
right?
Becoming one with source. So it's kind of like the New Age movement is all talking about ascension, or not ascension, awakening.
Mm-hmm.
Moving toward the light. Would that be a sort of a similar thing?
I guess it's hard for me to compare and contrast entire, you know, things of thought, but
maybe too broad.
Yeah, I think sometimes people talk about transcendence,
mm-hmm.
but it leaves us with this feeling of duality.
Right.
Like there's two realities, even if one of them is kind of temporary.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't believe that. I just really believe there's only one. That's the creation that God made, that love made.
Okay.
That it's spiritual, because God is spirit, so everything that comes from spirit is inherently spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't see us as transcending, you know, matter and problems and ourselves even,
mm-hmm.
as much as the Bible talks about looking through a glass darkly. So it's kind of like, you know, the good we see, the life, the beauty, the creativity, it's real, but it's spiritual. And yet we see it dimly, so we see it with all these distortions, and the distortions are kind of like the fine print or the asterisk, you know, that comes, that tries to sell you a good idea and says, but, you know, and so it's like, you know, you're alive, and that's beautiful, and that's a fact, and that's reality right here, and it's and right now.
Mm-hmm.
But there's all these little asterisks that say, but you were born into that life, meaning you have a beginning, and you will die out of that life, meaning you have an ending. And that's a distortion of the fact. That's a very limited, narrow view of what's going on here. And it says, meanwhile, in that life, you're vulnerable. You know, you can be sick. It's normal to have disordered bodily functions at times and things like that. And in fact, your whole life resides in these functions and depends on them. That, to me, is another distorted fact.
A distorted fact.
The distortion of the facts, maybe.
Distortion of the facts. And the fact is that we live forever and we're always healthy.
Yeah, so healing is about removing these distortions. It's about getting clearer about what already is, what's already true, and those ignorances and those misperceptions. It's not our fault, you know, but we do need to put them off in order to experience what God is already doing, what God is already creating, right here and right now. So, if we're talking about spirituality as transcendence in a dualistic way, I don't resonate with that myself.
Okay.
I think of it more as, you know, taking off the layers, the baggage, and really seeing what's right. But it's all in perception.
Mm-hmm.
It's not in actuality.
Right. It's all in perception, meaning that it's we're learning about it more and more.
Right.
And whatever we perceive is our truth in the moment.
Yeah, and that's what this is all about to me. It's the only thing that I think is relative and that changes the language we use. Some might call it God, some might not.
Mm-hmm.
Those are just words.
Right.
You know, even the path to me, actually, I was thinking about as I was saying this, the path is, it's the same things that get us there, every single one of us, you know? Love is going to work and hate is not. right? So it's not like some people can ascend the mountain through hate and some people are going to ascend it through love. There's only one way.
That's true.
And that's why Mary Baker Eddy called it a science. She really felt that it was exact, that it was specific, that you couldn't deviate from it.
Okay.
But that doesn't mean you can't. What I see is the exact same scientific things coming out, but sometimes in different language. You know what I mean? In other words, love is an exact thing, and you can't deviate from love. You can't be sort of loving. You can't be loving in an impure, a jealous, you know, kind of a way.
Yeah, you can't, because that's not the same thing.
It's the straight and narrow way, right? There's only one way, and that's love. And right. Everything else is trying to get us to go off to the right or off to the little. So then, you know, whatever people want to call it is fine. You know, those are just words or whatever symbols or things help people understand real, genuine love. Mm-hmm. But love is exact, and love is scientific, and there's just... That's what we're getting at.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, because I wanted to ask you about what that word science in the name
right
came from. She believed, and you believe, some Christian scientists believe that it is a science. What you believe?
A science indicates that something's timeless, like 2 and 2 equals 4, scientific fact. We don't wonder if it was true 2,000 years ago, but not today. Like 4.1 these days, maybe slipping a little bit. It's exact.
Right.
It's also universal. It's 2 and 2 is 4. We would never question if it was just as true for a little girl sitting in a village in Afghanistan today, mm-hmm. as it is for us right here and right now.
Mm-hmm.
It's not something we earn or work our way up to, and it's not something we can mess up. It just is. So to say that there's a science to this is to say that it's universal, it's timeless. It's also to say that it takes understanding. It's not just about blind faith.
Because mm-hmm.
you can't go into math class and say, I believe math works, and then expect that to be enough.
Right.
You can't just get your math test and go, I believe. You know.
Right.
You have to understand the rules, the principles, the laws behind it. And I think that's also what Mary Baker Eddy was getting at. Let's not just say we believe in the teachings of Jesus. Let's understand them. And Jesus said, I will know you, what is it? I'm messing it up now. But anyway, by the works you do,
mm-hmm.
You'll know the tree by its fruit, you know?
Right.
And he reiterates that quite a bit, actually, in his teachings. So if we say we believe, but we don't demonstrate in the same way that he did, we don't live, we don't accomplish the same work. He said, you will do the same works that I do and greater, because
mm-hmm.
I'm leaving now. I gave you what you need, and it's time for me to go.
Mm.
But to say that there's a science is to say we don't want to just say we believe in it. We want to understand it and then prove that understanding the same way. You can't just tell your math teacher, I understand this. You prove it. You do the equation, and when you get the resolution, you know you've got it.
Right. That's the only answer you can have.
Yeah.
That's one answer.
So those are all essential elements, and they were essential to her approach to Christianity.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's very interesting. I really am resonating with all of this.
Cool.
It's really fun to talk with you, Tom, today, all
you
about
too.
Christian science and Mary Baker Eddy, and how you came to be a practitioner of this, a healer. So you call yourself a Christian science healer.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's been fun. I just noticed the clock, and I realize our time has been flying by.
Yeah,
I've been having a lot of fun.
Coming close to the end.
Chris, I've been doing a lot of talking, so I don't know.
Well, that's good. No, but that's the only way I can learn is by letting you talk.
Yeah.
And it's really fascinating that Mary Baker Eddy was born in New Hampshire and this whole part of the country, because to me this is where the part of the country I come from, Massachusetts
mm-hmm.
and New Hampshire,
mm-hmm.
and how people are awakened to or guided to all of this, and how you are and how I am moving my life in a similar direction, and the whole thing is the basis of all this. All of this is love.
Yeah.
And that's what source energy is. That's what God is. That's what it is all about. So we're all coming at it from the same, coming to that top of the mountain, as you said, with a different path, but we're all going to the same, or I am going to the same place as you. But it's fascinating hearing it from the perspective of the Christian science faith and Mary Baker Eddy and how she came to this with such a determination to want to know.
Yeah.
And it feels like you came from a similar perspective of your philosophy, but your desire to know.
Yeah.
Something must be, something better.
Yeah. I feel if there was a distinction to make, it would be I feel like everything in my life is a glimpse, and I'm just trying to get it more and get it more and prove it more. And somebody like Mary Baker Eddy, she seemed to just, it clicked for her, and she seemed like she spent her whole life trying to explain it to others rather than trying to get it. I don't think that's, I mean, she's very humble when she writes and very much talks about her own progression and her own learning and her own growth, and that none of it was about her own power. It was all just learning from God, from the same source.
Uh-huh.
But she also, I mean, the reason she was so well known was because she helped and healed so many people.
Yeah.
And so much of it just, you know, documented, and not people who necessarily joined her church, but
mm-hmm.
Just healing freely, helping people freely.
Right.
Helping people see who they were,
mm-hmm.
What was already true.
Right. And how did she grow the church then?
People were attracted to the healing. You know, they wanted to buy her book. They wanted to study with her. It grew organically. It was,
mm-hmm.
And that's how the movement worldwide grew. People would learn. They'd help other people in their community. They'd heal. And then those people would want to know, and they'd learn, and they'd help, and they'd heal.
Mm-hmm.
So it was totally organic. It was just the spread of a really good idea.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Wow, it sounds great.
Yeah.
And her book was written in the 1850s, maybe? Or?
The first publication was in 1875, and there was major revisions all the way up until around 1910 when she passed. She just kept working on it. She
wow.
never stopped. Yeah.
So she died in 1910.
Yep.
Okay. And so this was her life path. She just
devoted everything to it. Never retired. 89 years old at a time when life expectancy was probably half that,
uh-huh.
you know, for general population. And in her 89th year, she's there establishing the Christian Science Monitor, you know, global uh-huh. newspaper, in the middle of all the yellow journalism at the time, saying, no, we need truth, people, you know, and still around today.
Mm-hmm.
Again, at a time when women couldn't even vote, you know,
right,
and here she was
right.
starting a business. And
that's amazing. So she's an amazing woman. To look up to, as well as the many other women that we have in the background.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, thank you so much.
You're
this
really
has been
welcome.
Really interesting to talk with you, Tom.
It's
Tom
been
McElroy.
A joy to be here. Thank you.
Of the Christian Science Church, Christian Science Board of Lectureship. And just to review, Tom will be lecturing in New Hampshire in Concord on December 2nd, Tuesday, at 7:30 at the Kimball Jenkins Estate at the Carraige House, December 2nd. And then December 7th, Tom will be in Plymouth at the library at 7:30 probably again. Or
That's at 2 p.m. in the afternoon.
Oh, that's 2 p.m. because
it's
a Sunday.
Yeah.
It's a Sunday. So 2 p.m. in the afternoon at the Plymouth Library on December 7th. And the title of that again is?
The Real You. No limitations.
The real you, no limitations. Woohoo! That's what we do here, all right? The real you and no limitations, because there are no limitations on the real you, the real me, the real you. There are no limitations, so I love that.
Amen.
I'm going to try and make it to one of those. I'm not sure which one, but I'm that'll be fun.
It'll be fun to see you there.
So thank you all for joining us today, and I hope you enjoyed the program. And if you want to see Tom again, I'm going to have some kind of a link up on my website. And until next week, remember, your heart knows the way. Ah, thank you.